Welcome to worship for Sunday, October 4th. Please join me in our call to worship. The sun rises without fail, bringing a crisp new day to earth. And we rise to embrace this October time of worship.
Flowers, trees, grasses, and pumpkins and squash of all different colors flourish and give praise with unfolding leaves, waving blades and fragrant offerings. May we join them and praise the Creator with our whole being. We gather as people who wonder and wander. We participate and pull back. We are faithful at times and frail at other times.
May life-giving ways be open for us and within us. Some people know what it is to struggle, to be broken but not crushed, to despair yet be held by unseen love.
May life-giving ways be opened for us and within us. As a river carries life within its flowing currents, may we encounter this day the spirit of the one in whom there is life and love for us all.
May life-giving ways be open for us and within us.
Friends, today we are focusing on how true life comes to us through following God's law. Before the Ten Commandments were handed down to us, in the pages of printed Bibles, they were written on ink, on papyrus, paper made from reeds from the River Nile. And before papyrus, these words were etched on parchment, on the skins of animals. And before that, the Ten Commandments were most likely carved in stone, which is very hard to do. So they were written tersely in one-word summaries. Most likely, when the Israelites first read the tablets from Sinai, they read only 10 single words. Words like idolatry, murder, adultery, coveting. 10 words, each one stood for an important idea. This is how ancient contracts were made. And we still, today we say, when a contract is firm, we say it's written in stone. That's where we get this. God was making a contract with the people of Israel. These 10 words were shorthand for a rule of life that would guide the people of Israel along their journey to becoming the nation that was promised long ago to Abraham. In the 16th century, Martin Luther, our reformer, said that every negative word in this list also stands for a positive. For example, Luther said, "Do not murder" means support the living and care for them and do everything you can to keep people alive. These words reflect the power of words to create heartfelt responses that give shape to community. So rather than speaking with a prayer that has already written sentences today, we're gonna speak single words now, and we invite you to attend to the thoughts and feelings that arise with each word. Allow these responses to guide your silent prayer of confession.
Distrust, distance, division, brokenheartedness.
Harm, acquisition, neglect, pollution, extinction.
Disregard, ignore, disrespect, greed, injustice, impoverishment.
Friends, with the heaviness of these words on our hearts, we invite you to now meditate upon life-giving words.
Respect, receive, welcome, reconcile, enfold.
Restore, conserve, beautify, care.
Attend, share, compassion, love.
Forgiven, 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 forgiven. May these life-giving words take root within us and become God's life-giving reality among us and through us.
Sustains the community of creation and brings joy and purpose to all who live within God's love and sphere. Throughout history, many laws have changed, and people say the law has life if it changes, and would by definition be dead if it could not be changed. But some laws are eternal. Psalm 19 extols the Creator's ordinances as more to be desired than gold and sweeter than honey. The loving words of wisdom set down in the Ten Commandments give shape to human community and enable all creation to flourish. So we have three questions to consider today. What laws in our country and our community are life-giving, liberating of all people's possibilities? And which increase opportunity for human thriving now and in the future? The second question, what do today's stories say about what God considers to be important for human beings as we live in community with God and with one another? And third, just something to keep in the back of your mind, do you experience these words as sweeter than honey and more desirable than fine gold and a goal worth pursuing, as the psalmist says? So pray with me. Prayerfully, Holy Spirit, we ask you to fill our minds and hearts today with your wisdom as we listen to scripture and consider today's questions and stories. Amen. Alex is going to read our first reading. And while he does, it's going to be the part where the Ten Commandments first show up. I'm going to name the commandment and invite you to summarize the commandment, much as our Boy Scouts did a couple of years ago, or last year. It seems like a really long time, but it was last year. Hold on, I think you'll remember. So hold on, Alex.
Okay.
So Alex will read the command, and I will say the number, and then I'll hold up a sign, and you guys can respond with the summation. It's either love my God for the first four, or love my neighbor for the last six.
A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 to... A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 to 20. From the cloud... Oh my gosh, I'm very sorry.
It's okay.
A reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 to 20. From the cloud up high on Mount Sinai, God spoke all these words to Moses, the leader of the people of Israel. I am Yahweh, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me.
The first commandment, love my God.
You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth.
The second commandment, love my God.
You shall not make wrongful use of the name Yahweh, your God, for Yahweh will not acquit anyone who misuses his name.
The third commandment, love my God.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days.
Oh, hold on. Remember the Sabbath. Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot. Go ahead.
Oh my God. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it.
And this is the long form of the fourth commandment. So love my God.
Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that Yahweh, your God, has given you.
The fifth commandment, love my neighbor.
You shall not murder.
The sixth commandment, love my neighbor.
You shall not commit adultery.
The seventh commandment, love my neighbor.
You shall not steal.
The eighth commandment, love my neighbor.
You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor.
The ninth commandment, love my neighbor.
You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor.
The tenth commandment, love my neighbor.
Then all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning, the sound of the trumpet, and the mountain smoking. They were afraid and trembled and stood at a distance, and said to Moses, "You speak to us, and we will listen. But do not let God speak to us, or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you, and put the fear of him upon you, so that you do not sin." Then the people stood at a distance, while Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. Here ends the first reading.
Now hear the gospel from the 21st chapter of Matthew, verses 33 through 46. "Listen to another parable," Jesus said to his disciples and the people who assembled to hear him teach, including the chief priests and Pharisees. Jesus said, "There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, and dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to the tenants and went to another country.
When the harvest time came, The landlord sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized the slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent another slaves, more than the first. And his tenants treated them the same way. Finally, the landlord sent his sons, then saying, "Surely they will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, they threw him out of the vineyard, and they killed him.
So Jesus asked, "Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?"
The people in the crowd answered Jesus, "He will put those wretches to death, a miserable death, and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at harvest time."
Jesus said to the crowd, "Have you never read the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls."
When the chief priests and Pharisees heard the parables of Jesus, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest Jesus, but they feared the crowds because the people regarded Jesus as a prophet. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So today's New Testament story about the vineyard, very troubling story. I had a hard time writing about it, but I worked through it, and I hope I found some good in it. So today's story happens at a clear turning point in the Gospel of Matthew. Chapter 21 begins with Jesus and his disciples entering Jerusalem and purposely creating a spectacle with the crowds. This is Christ's triumphant entry to Jerusalem at the end of his life, and we celebrated with this text on Palm Sunday. Matthew is the gospel writer who shows how Jesus creatively fulfills the promises of Hebrew scripture. So Jesus is like giving us a gloss or a commentary on scripture, showing how the promises can be fulfilled in his time. Matthew portrays Jesus as one who was reminding everyone of a quote from Zechariah, a promise about a victorious ruler, God's victorious ruler, who will be so humble that when he enters in triumph, unlike the Romans who came with all their centurions and on horseback and with chariots, Zechariah says that God's ruler will come humbler still as a donkey, and so humble that it won't just be a big old donkey, it'll be a colt, a young donkey. Matthew says that Jesus supersized these two animals in true humility, and he rode on both of them. I think this is a kind of playfulness, and the people are playing along with him. And listen now to this text from Zechariah. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I think Jesus is playing with the people because Hebrew poetry has this thing where it repeats its final words in a way that intensifies it the second time. If you look on the Psalms, you'll see this. It's like, oh my God, do they have to say everything twice? But yes, the answer is yes. So this is kind of an in-joke for Jesus riding on the colt and the donkey, both of the animals. When Jesus does this, he's joking about this habit of Hebrew poetry to intensify itself and double things. And the people get the joke. A very large crowd played along with Jesus, spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees, that's where we get the palms, and spread them on the ground. The crowds that went ahead of Jesus and those that followed behind Jesus were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. These are also quotes from Scripture. They're all playing. They're doing a play of Scripture. Jesus is pointing out the radical difference between servant leadership and leadership that's happening in his time and place. Servant leadership is what we talked about last week with Joseph and his brothers. The kind of leadership Jesus talks about when he says the last shall be first. An entitled non-reverent leadership, leaders who are focused on their own aggrandizement, they will be the last in God's kingdom. So Matthew goes on at this point and says, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, and they were asking, because of this spectacle, who is this? And the crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. Matthew continues and tells us that Jesus jumped off the coat and the donkey and entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of people who sold doves. And he quoted to them from the prophets. It is written, Jesus says, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. Matthew goes on to say that the blind and the lame came to Jesus at that point, and Jesus cured them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the amazing things that Jesus did and heard the children crying in the temple, Hosanna to the Son of David, they became very angry. I think they were worried that Jesus might have been trespassing on those first four commandments about the holiness of God. And they said to Jesus, do you hear what these are saying? And Jesus said, have you never read, out of the mouth of infant and nursing babes, you have prepared praise for yourself? Jesus is saying, in what God is doing today, God is being recognized and praised. That night Jesus left and went back to Bethany with his friends and spent the night there. But the next day he came back and entered the temple, and the chief priests and the elders came to him and said, they were ready with their question now, by what authority are you doing these things? Who gave you this authority? So the Greek word for authority is exousia. It means power. Where did you get this power? By whose authority are you claiming your leadership and your power? And Jesus asked them a question. Jesus reminds them of John, whom their secular leader, Herod, had beheaded. And Jesus said, I'll answer your question when you answer this question. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another. They said, if we say from heaven, Jesus will say, well, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we're in trouble because all the crowds revere John as a prophet. So they had a problem because they had to say that there was power outside of their own group, right? So they answered Jesus, we don't know. And Jesus said, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. And that's when Jesus starts saying his parables. So the first parable is, a man had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. And the son said, I will not, much as I have heard over 37 years of parenting. But later, that son changed his mind and went. But the father didn't know he was going to go. So he went to his second son and said the same thing. And the son said, I go, sir. But then he did not go. Which of the two did the will of the father, Jesus asked. And they said the first. And Jesus said to those chief priests and Pharisees, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and prostitutes believed him. Even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. So the question today is about authority. Whom should we believe? And how do we know? It's the same question we considered with Joseph. Why shouldn't we kill this annoying or do something really bad to this annoying little brother? Or why shouldn't we sell out the sinners or the people who are poor and who are asking for help? Why shouldn't we act as if God's laws don't really exist in some cases? Underlying today's parable, Jesus answers the question about the authority in the kingdom of God. But it's not an answer that he says in like a dictum. It's an answer that we get in our hearts, much as the people just answer spontaneously. The owner leaves his vineyard in the care of his tenants, and he's relying on time-worn ethical boundaries. A sense of justice would have the tenants pay back their landlord. A sense of goodwill and even enlightened self-interest might make the tenants think twice about killing the landlord's servants. But the tenants that Jesus describes uphold absolutely no authority except for their own greed. Not only are the lives of the landlord's servants worthless to them, but even the landlord's own son's life is nothing but an impediment to them. It's shocking. And Jesus is saying it's so hard to believe that people are going to act this way. The landlord is very gullible. And I feel like we're gullible too. We can't believe that people would be that mean. But Jesus says, believe me, they are. In this story, Jesus reveals that life without God, what it looks like. Like the landlord, we might be shocked that these tenants are so brutal and ruthless, but Jesus is showing us what happens to people who have no sense of God-given authority. This story is a glimpse of life without justice, without reverence for life, without reverence for family ties. Jesus asked the crowd, now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do? What will the landlord do to the tenants? And the crowd has no doubt. The crowd knows. The crowd has God's sense of justice in their hearts. And so they say, he'll put those wretches out to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time. And that's when Jesus says, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. So Jesus is saying that God has a law that's much bigger, and God puts these impediments in front of us. And he tells them, the Pharisees and the chief priests who have plotted against Jesus, that the kingdom of God will be taken away from them and given to people that produce the fruits of the kingdom. And this is the point where it becomes clear that Jesus is talking about God's people in the vineyard, and where Jesus is making a value judgment that the people who are leading God's people are godless, even though they wear the trappings of God, even though they sacrifice in the temple. When the chief priests and Pharisees heard this, they realized he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they regarded him as a prophet. They knew the people did, so they were afraid of the power of the people. So I think what's important here is this weird part about the cornerstone, which kind of jumps out, and I kind of struggled with that cornerstone. What is Jesus talking about there? And so I went back, because Matthew leaves these little breadcrumbs for us, and sometimes we have to turn back the pages and not just read about the cornerstone, but what was the context? And that passage comes from Psalm 118, a psalm of victory. And so that's why Susan and Emily today sang a song of victory for us about goodness stronger than evil and darkness, light stronger than darkness. It's a song from Africa, and it's a song about the end of one people subjecting another people. So a little bit from Psalm 118, Jesus connects all these threads. It's so beautiful. He connects all the threads from his triumphant final entry into Jerusalem with victory in God. So listen to this psalm that connects all the threads of today's reading. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, the righteous shall enter through it. And so Jesus has entered the gate with all of his people. I thank you, Lord, that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. That's what Hosanna means. Hosanna, save us. O Lord, beseech you. So Jesus has woven himself and the people and his message for the Pharisees all into this psalm. And he's enacted it. He's become the embodiment of this. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. Hosanna. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success or victory. Blessed is the one who comes in the name. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. And this is the last bit. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. He even put Palm Sunday branches in there. So what is Jesus saying? I think he's saying that in vanquishing Jesus, the chief priests and Pharisees are actually, they think they're getting rid of him, just like they did John, but they're actually ushering in God's kingdom. How does this happen? I think it happens by revealing themselves to be greedy tenants, the ones who've usurped God's vineyards, who've trammeled God's law by ruthlessly only considering their own enrichment of their own position. They serve only themselves. They owe nothing to God, not in their words, but in their actions. Their utter godlessness is revealed. It's certainly revealed when they take Jesus and they have the Romans crucify him. Their purely greedy selfishness becomes apparent. They brutally execute God's son, the vineyard owner's own son, and that means that they have no care for any of the others. Their public descent into depravity, into pure aggrandizing evil, is God's victory, because they cannot kill God. And so I think in some ways that QAnon is kind of right. QAnon is crazy, right? But in some ways it's right, because probably there are no politicians who are actually pedophiles and who actually drink the blood of their victims. But as the chief priests and the Pharisees look harmless enough, Jesus is saying, beware their greed. They sacrifice innocent people for their own enrichment. So last week we looked at Joseph and his brothers. We saw that Joseph had faith. Joseph's faith was that he always knew that God was much greater than all the evil that his stupid brothers did to him, and that his Egyptian master and his wife did to him, and his dungeon master, anything they could all do. Joseph lived the faith that God was always bigger than all of that evil. Like Jesus, Joseph took the blows of evil on himself, but never gave up faith that God's victory was much, much bigger. And that's the same faith that Jesus is calling on us to have here today. So let's praise God, for God's gate of righteousness is wider than all the evil deeds of our days. Let's praise God that the greedy on this earth, through their blatant destruction of God's people and all God's creation, they will be vanquished. And let us thank God that we can cling to Jesus, the stone that was rejected. And let us love God and love one another, just as we did in our Ten Commandments. And it's our job to lift these up for our community, in each of our lives, and in our church together. And so let us praise God that we may follow in the way of the stone that was rejected, in our Lord who was disrespected, the cornerstone, Jesus Christ. So pray with me. Holy God, in this beautiful autumnal season, where yet, as in all days, all kinds of evil is being revealed, help us to become faithful witnesses to your justice, to your goodness, to your love, to your truth. Amen.
The trees in the forest and the roots underground. Our Father above us, whose sigh is the wind, paint us a rainbow without any end. As the river runs freely, the mountain does rise. Let me touch with my fingers and see with my eyes, in the hearts of the children a pure love still grows. Like a bright star in heaven that lights our way home, like the flower that shattered the stone. Sparrows find freedom beholding the sun. In the infinite beauty, we're all joined in one. I reach out before me and look to the sky. Did I hear someone whisper, did something pass by? As the river runs freely, the mountain does rise. Let me touch with my fingers and see with my eyes, in the hearts of the children of your love still grows. like a bright star in heaven. That lights our way home, like the flower that shattered the storm. Like the bright star in heaven, that lights our way home, like the flower that shattered the storm.
We are so grateful for everyone's contributions to the church and its missions. Let us dedicate our offerings in prayer. Lord, you have provided for all our needs. You have ensured that our daily needs are met. You have promised that we have no need to worry about what we will eat or what we will wear. You have provided it all. We are rich beyond compare, not always in money, but still we are rich in all that you have given us. We offer our gifts of money today, knowing that they are only a small part of all that we offer. Our whole being, our energy, our passion, our desire for the kingdom. Accept these offerings, take them and use them in the world. Amen.
Please join me in our final prayers for others and ourselves. Creative One, eternally loving and merciful, we thank you for the gift of life, for the universe with all its beauty and abundance. Lord, our knowledge of good and evil has not helped us to make the world a better place. Instead, it has allowed some of us to manipulate and abuse the earth's resources and people. Lord, we pray that your wisdom, expressed through Holy Scripture, and through our actions and the actions of your faithful children, may pervade the world and all its people, and bring healing and prosperity to all. Lord, history reveals a catalog of bad or selfish decisions by too many leaders and people in power.
In the 23rd chapter of Exodus, you prohibit us from evil. You say, you shall not spread a false report. You shall not join hands with the wicked to act as a malicious witness. You shall not follow a majority in wrongdoing. When you bear witness in a lawsuit, you shall not side with the majority to pervert justice. Lord, we pray that your wisdom may pervade the world and all its people, bringing better decisions and better use of power. Lord, some people continue to use manipulation and lies to gain our trust and to get us to choose options that, in the end, take us away from you and other people. Lord, we pray that your wisdom may pervade the world and its people. May it bring a change in how people relate to one another. May it reduce false promises and false and dangerous mythologies. May it reveal all deception and manipulation, especially where people are fooled into working against their own good.
Lord, some of us never learn to take responsibility for our choices or actions. And in doing so, we create conflict with others. Lord, we pray that your wisdom may pervade the world and its people, bringing acknowledgement and acceptance of our choices, and moving forward together to live with the consequences. Loving God, may we accept that you are wiser than we can ever imagine, and freely offer to guide us in our ways in this life. Help us to listen to your guidance and to live a life that is wise and that creates beauty and humility among all your children on this earth.
Friends, as we hear in the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. In all your ways acknowledge God, and God will make straight your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing for your flesh and a refreshment for your body. So we pray today for all people who are mourning, including families of 209,000 plus people living in the U.S. who lost their lives, and 1 million around the world. We pray for all who are struggling with active infections, especially people in the White House on whom we rely, our president, his wife, and many people in our federal government. We pray for all who are struggling with illness. We pray for all who are combating illness. We pray for everyone who's working for a cure and everyone who's working for a vaccine. We pray for all the public health people who are keeping us safe. We pray for people with illness that isn't COVID-19. There are many of them, we can't forget them. And Carol Van de Giesen asks us in particular to pray for her sister-in-law, who is also Sarah's aunt, Sherry. She lives in Canada. So God be with Sherry, who's having surgery this week. Guide her medical team in surgery and afterwards, and accompany her in her recovery. And we pray with thanksgiving too. We pray with thanksgiving for Bob Lefevre's nephew, Sean, and his new wife, Susmita. Their wedding was just yesterday, and they shared it as a true feast, like the Feast of Cana, sharing joy, incredible joy, in the midst of a time of sadness as they are still mourning Sean's mother and Bob's sister. And we also pray a happy birthday to our singer, Emily Smalley, whose birthday is tomorrow. And let's all stay for a minute after our final benediction and sing happy birthday to her. Okay, and now let us thank God for this gift. Our Lord is Jesus, God's Son, in whose life we find the way, the truth, and the life, so that following Jesus in service as true servant leaders, we can join together in the prayer that Jesus gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name.
Just a couple of announcements before we close. If you look over there at our clothing shed, you'll see that it's open for business. So this is really good news. It's time to clean out our closets and usher in the beauty of fall. Also, I would ask, we collected so many clothes for the Gransky family that many of them are piled up. So if you're comfortable and you could go down and fill one of the bags that are down there with clothing and just drop it off at the clothing shed either today, right before you leave, or anytime this week, it would be great. If we all do a little bit, we'll actually get paid for this good work. Also, I wanted to say, I forgot in our prayers that we're still praying for our educators and teachers who are on the front line. I still have a few of our thank you cards. And so Carolyn and Colleen, thank you to our teachers. Our teachers are really on the front lines of this, along with the healthcare, and they are doing so much to keep God's promise open for our young people. Also, we're running something new. Last week, we had the women here from Good News Home for Women, and they loved coming, and they hope to come back, but they did say that they need coats. And I was talking with Judy Eislin, and together we were thinking, well, we probably all have a lot of coats that we can put in the clothing shed, but for these women, we'd like to try to collect as much as possible in gift cards so that the women could go themselves to Burlington Coat Factory and buy their own coat that makes them feel happy and makes them feel like they have a warm hug from their communities. So these are people who've been rejected by their families. We want them to know that God's love is here for them, and this is a wonderful way to do it. So someone already slipped some money into my pocket. So any way you want to do it, cash, buy a gift card. You can buy your gift card online. You can leave it in the office. You can give it to me. Any way. We just want to collect money and gift cards for these women. So now, let's bow our heads and receive God's blessing. And this blessing is especially for Emily, who's here. Bless it, yes.
Next Saturday, 22 years.
22 years, another joy that we need to give thanks to God. 22 years of beautiful marriage for Colleen and Phil. So we thank them for giving us the gift of reading and song. Let's thank them. Let's extend our hands on Emily right now, because she has been a blessing for us in this season. Emily, we bless you, and we bless everyone here with a week full of blessing, with hearts full of gratitude, full of meaning in God's word, with minds that are at rest. May your soul be stirred to action. May you find God guiding you, and Jesus, God's only Son, walking with you. And may the Holy Spirit inspire your autumn days. Amen. So shall we sing happy birthday to Emily?
Okay.
Happy birthday